Hey everyone, Magistra DC here, and today it's time for us to finally learn about the future tense, which is the third tense of the present system. Please make sure to have your verb charts in front of you, as you will need to take notes on them. As soon as you look at the future tense on the verb chart, you should notice that it's different automatically because it appears as though there are two future tenses. And there isn't really a second future tense or two future tenses, but there are two different sets of future tense endings. The title of the future tense, whether we're looking at future tense 1 and 2 or future tense 3 and 4, tells us on which conjugation of verb each of these endings will be added. So the verbs are actually divided in the future tense into two groups. The first group has first and second conjugation in it, and the second group has third and fourth conjugation. That also includes third IO. First and second conjugation verbs use a different set of future tense endings than the third and fourth conjugation verbs do. I have a couple of little mnemonic devices to help you remember the future tense, including a song, but also some mnemonic devices that help you associate spellings of the endings. For example, we say, or I like to say, that future tense for first and second conjugation verbs is stinky. And I know it's stinky because it has B-O. So the first person singular ending for the future tense is bo. Now you should notice right away, if you can stop chuckling for a moment, that the O is a typical ending representing the subject I. So we are going to see, just as we did for the imperfect tense, that the future tense will reutilize the personal endings for each of the subjects. Now our future tense for first and second conjugation may be stinky, but it isn't because he refuses to bathe. He is an athlete, and I know that he is an athlete because of the third person plural ending, bunt. What sport does our future tense first and second conjugation verb play? Baseball, of course, because that's where you bunt in baseball. It's also important to focus on these two future tense endings because they will use different vowels before the endings or as an ending than will all of the rest of the forms. All of the other forms start with the letters B-I, and then the personal ending is added after that. So we have bis, bit, bimus, and bitis. Like that. So the future tense endings for first and second conjugation are stinky because they start with B-O. We know that they're stinky not because they refuse to bathe, but because they are athletes who've just finished their practice, and we know that they are baseball players because they are bunting. And then we have to remember that everything else in between is B-I, bi. The translation for the future tense is really simple. We use either shall or will. Actually, let me modify that. With the subjects I or we say shall, and then whatever the verb is. So I shall love you, we shall love. And then with all the other subjects, so you, he, she, it, and they, we say will verb. I shall love, you will love, he will love, we shall love, you will love, they will love. Now, shall is extremely formal, and that is the most correct form to use for the first person singular and plural. Will is the marker for the future tense with all the other subjects. If you forget to say shall and use will, it's not an egregious error, and if you were taking a pencil paper test, I would not mark it wrong. And if you were to do that on a Moodle test, and that's the error that you made, when I look at the answers again, I would go back in and give you the points for that. The reason that they are different and that we have to understand the difference is because when I say that I will do something, I'm actually making a promise. I will myself to do something. And it's a very strong message that we are sending when we say that. Therefore, we need to be very judicious about when we say will with I and we. Remember, this only happens for the subjects I and we. So those are the future tense endings for first and second conjugation. Bo, bis, bit, bimus, bittis, bunt. Remember that because we are still in the present system, we find the base of the verb by going to our second principal part. And first and second conjugation verbs use the same connecting vowel no matter what conjugation we're dealing with. So if you're adding these endings to a first conjugation verb, you'll see the letter A in front of them. And if you're adding them to a second conjugation verb, you'll see the letter E in front of them. Let's get a piece of paper and practice conjugating a couple of first and second conjugation verbs in the future tense. If you don't have paper, having a whiteboard nearby or typing it out on your computer or on your phone is a great idea. If you have an iPad or something like that, that's also a great idea, just to kind of jot the words down. So we're going to take the verb that means to praise, which is laudo, laudara. We are going to conjugate it into Latin. In English, it would be, I shall praise, you will praise, he will praise, we shall praise, you will praise, and they will praise. But what will this look like in Latin? Remember that you need to start with the base, which is L-A-U-D, and then you need to add the connecting vowel for the appropriate conjugation. This is first, so A is the connecting vowel. And then you need to attach the appropriate future tense ending for the subject I, which is stinky or bo, so laudabo. You finish the rest. You probably want to have your future tense notes in front of you, since you probably haven't memorized those endings yet. And see if you can write the remaining forms for the first conjugation verb to praise in the future tense. Did you get those first three? Congratulations if you did. If you're not sure why those answers are correct, don't hesitate to email and ask a question. Go ahead and make sure you do the next three before I put the answers on the screen. And there we have our first conjugation verb in the first, second, and third person plural. Misspelled that ending. Should be a U. Laudabunt. So laudabo, laudabis, laudabit, laudabimus, laudabitis, laudabunt. Let's try one for second conjugation. To sit, which is sedeo, sedera. I'm going to let you conjugate the whole verb. Remember, this is second conjugation, so instead of using A as a connecting vowel, it will use the letter, do you know? I hope you're saying E. And then I'd also like you to give an appropriate English translation for each verb form. I'll wait while you do the work. So I've got my base and my connecting vowel ready to go, and then I'll be ready to attach my ending. This would be the same for any of the three tenses that we've worked with. Remember that the base tells us which of the tenses we're working with, but the ending also tells us what tense we are working with. So there are the Latin forms. Did you get those correct? Remember that if you don't, you want to make sure to email and make sure that you understand what you did wrong or how you're supposed to get it right if you're not sure you understand how to do that. If you wrote, "I will sit," I would mark that correct on your test paper. Though it is more correct and more proper to say, "I shall sit." If you wrote, "We will sit," instead of "we shall sit," that's okay. I would mark that correct on your test paper. Notice that I'm not giving you the option of writing shall for the subjects you, he, or they. And that's because you do not want to use shall with those subjects. When you actually put shall with you or they or he, you're creating something called a future imperative. You shall sit. Which means that you have to sit at some point in the future. It's a little strange. Cool, so that's how we do a first and second conjugation verb, how we conjugate a first and second conjugation verb in the future tense. Let's go back to our chart and take a look at the future tense endings for third and fourth conjugation, which must be from Lancaster County or someplace in Ohio, because I like to think of them as being Amish, because they start with A-M. I also know that they're Amish because they have an uncle whose name is Amos. Uncle Amos. It's important to focus on these two endings because A, they both start with different vowels. So by remembering Amish, we remember Am. And when we remember Uncle Amos, the E, which is a long E in this particular ending, is the vowel that the remaining third and fourth declension future tense endings will start with. So you'll have the letter E in front of the ending that represents the subject that you're looking at. So second person singular would be S. Third person singular will be et. Second person plural would be atis. And third person plural will be ent. Am, ace, et. Amos, atis, ent. Am, ace, et. Amos, atis, ent. And of course, the translations are exactly the same. We're still in the future tense. It's just that we're talking about a third or fourth conjugation verb, and so the endings will look different. I have to say that future tense, third and fourth conjugation verbs in the future tense are one of the more difficult verbs to recognize when you are reading, because the endings don't have really very distinguishing features or characteristics about them. You know, they don't have a ba or a bo or a boo or a bi hanging out in front of them. It's just a vowel. And sometimes it's really confusing and looks just like a connecting vowel. So this is an opportunity for us to really emphasize learning vocabulary and knowing something about vocabulary and the conjugation of a verb. It's also that place where those of us who are super Latin students are going to rise above and really shine, and those of us who are just kind of interested in learning about the language but don't really care so much about being super Latin students are going to kind of see why we're not super Latin students, because we're going to maybe not recognize the future tense verb forms when we're reading sentences. The cool thing about it, though, is that when we're reading in Latin, the future tense is not used very often. And when it is, there are other verbs or words, I should say, in the sentence that help to give us context. So we sort of instinctually know that the future tense is being used. Once again, we're going to start with the traditional base of the second principal part. Then I want you to scoot down and take a look at those connecting vowels with me. You should notice that the third conjugation in the future tense does not use any connecting vowel whatsoever. It uses none. Isn't that interesting? I think the reason it doesn't is because the future tense endings for third conjugation already begin with a vowel, so they don't actually use the connecting vowel. Now, when we deal with third IO and fourth conjugation, because that I is so strong, it's going to make an appearance in every tense. So you actually will see the letter I in third IO and fourth conjugation as the connecting vowel before each of these future tense endings. And you will pronounce it also. You will pronounce both the I and the am, ace, et, amus, atis, ent. Let's practice conjugating a few third and third IO and fourth conjugation verbs. Let's pull back our paper here and turn this into third and fourth conjugation verbs. And let's start with the third conjugation verb that means to send. So I want to write it in the future tense. I want to write, I shall send. I'm going to start with my base, and then I'm going to add my connecting vowel. But I have to remember that third conjugation verbs don't use a connecting vowel. So then I just attach my ending, which is am. Then we write, you will send. So you go ahead and you write the Latin and I'll write the English. He will send. We shall send. You will send and they will send. So I'll give you a little bit of time to get caught up as you finish writing the Latin. So I have the base, and now I'm just going to go through and attach my future tense 3 and 4 endings, ace, et, amus, atus, ent. Here's our third I-O verb, facio, facere, to make or do. I'd like you to practice conjugating this third I-O verb in the future tense, and then I would like you to translate each form. Now don't forget that when you're looking for connecting vowels on the chart, this verb is third I-O, and so you are going to have a connecting vowel for the future tense. And that vowel will be I. So we will have faciam, facies, faciet. My T is sticking. Faciemus, facietis, and faciet. And our translations are I shall make, you will make, he will make, we shall make, you will make, and they will make. Of course, if you translated it with do, that's fine. And if you said I will and we will instead of shall, I would not mark those wrong. Let's practice conjugating one more verb together. Let's pick a fourth conjugation verb this time. Pick in our friend dormio, dormira, which means to sleep. You do not need to write the English translations. Simply write the verb or conjugate the verb dormio, dormira, to sleep in the future tense. This, of course, is the base of the verb, which you get by removing the IRE. Because this is fourth conjugation, it's going to use the connecting vowel I. And then we attach the future tense endings for third and fourth conjugation. Amus, et, amus, atus, ent. So we have dormiam, dormies, dormiet, dormiemus, dormietis, dormient. And that's how you conjugate verbs in the future tense. Now, I already promised you that there was a song to also help you remember the future tense endings for third and fourth conjugation. It's a hybrid song. It's kind of to the tune of If You're Happy and You Know, Clap Your Hands. And it's a little bit like the Mexican hat dance song, too. And, of course, there are two verses. It sounds like this. Bo, bis, bit, bimus, bitis, bunt, future tense for one and two with a knick-knack. Oh, I said it was going to sound like Mexican hat dance. I'm wrong. That's for the future tense of to be. This sounds like This old man, he played one. He played knick-knack on my drum with a knick-knack paddywhack. Get yourself an A. That's my song. Give your dog a bone. This old man came rolling home. So this is what it sounds like. Let me try again. Bo bis bit, bimus bitis bunt. Future tense for one and two with a knick-knack paddywhack. Get yourself an A. Learn these endings right away. And then we go to verse two. Ace et, amus atus ent. Future tense for three and four with a knick-knack paddywhack. Get yourself an A. Learn these endings right away. Now, if you're by yourself or with another group of Latin students, don't be embarrassed and sing out loud with me. Singing these out loud and saying them out loud is one of the ways that will really help you to remember them. Are you ready? Let's try it together. On the count of three, one, two, three. Bo bis bit, bimus bitis bunt. Future tense for one and two with a knick-knack paddywhack. Get yourself an A. Learn these endings right away. Ace et, amus atus ent. Future tense for three and four with a knick-knack paddywhack. Get yourself an A. Learn these endings right away. Cool. Let's try it one more time, just for kicks. And then I promise we'll be done. You ready? Here we go. Bo bis bit, bimus bitis bunt. Future tense for one and two with a knick-knack paddywhack. Get yourself an A. Learn these endings right away. Ace et, amus atus ent. Future tense for three and four with a knick-knack paddywhack. Get yourself an A. Learn these endings right away. Cool. I hope you find that helpful. When you're done with this, you can go right on to the flashcards to practice the future tense endings. And then there is a set of flashcards for a comprehensive look at the future tense with all four conjugations together. And then once you have finished those flashcards, you can take the Checking for Understanding quiz, and then you'll move on to learning about the future tense for the irregular verbs to be and to be able. So I'll talk to you then. Have fun with it.